Okay, we'll get back on here. Sorry about that. Welcome. Afternoon. Amos Sheffield, 2978 Hall Drive, Donaldsonville, Georgia, down in Seminole County. I'm the probate judge there, election superintendent, magistrate, and we do the vital record stuff there too. Kind of a jack of all trades, master of none, it seems like. I've got here with me David Faircloth. I made a note to say that. David's my right-hand man. It's a big guy sitting behind me, a Navy vet here. Good guy. So anything that I talk about, he knows about. He's usually right there with me. This comes from a mayor's election. It's one of those real contested mayor's elections like they were talking about in Atkinson County. We have them there in Seminole County from time to time. I don't know the lady that made the complaint. I've never heard her name before, which is odd. And I've asked around about her. Nobody seems to know who she is. But none of the allegations that she made, as I understood it, had any kind of foundation. The investigator Touchman came down and talked to us and sifted through everything we had. And he's a good guy to work with. We made everything available to him. He was real courteous to us. The voter certificates, there's two issues. There's voter certificates and then a thing with Mr. The voter there. With the voter certificates, that was just a boneheaded thing for my poll workers to do. And I've got some really good poll workers that have been with me. They were there when I took office in 2010, and they'll be there long after I'm gone. Just really good people. This is one where it looks like early in the morning as we're getting crunk up, they didn't sign the voter certificates as the people came in. People still got to vote. All the votes counted. Didn't mess with the election. With Mr. Fed, that's all on me, or Charlie Fred Hicks, I guess. As an election superintendent, I'll handle the stuff at the courthouse, but I'll go around to all the polling places and check on things. And so I happen to be in there helping out at the polling place when he's Fed is who he is. He came in there to vote. He was there with his niece, and he had his driver's license that said Charlie Fred Hicks. So he presents it to them, and of course he's not on the list. So they looked at it. Well, Miss Vera Manley has been working elections forever. She lives there in that precinct. She said, "That's not your name." I'd already started filling out the provisionals, ballot information, letting vote provisional. Somebody else there, I forget who it was, they said the same thing. They said, "That's not your name." And I looked at him and I recognized him as one of the feds. We got a bunch of them in Seminole County. And that's when we got talking to him, and it was my decision to stop the provisional process and let him vote on the DRE, because I knew it was, in hindsight, not the thing to do, but I knew him, I knew who he was, I knew we had he was on our voter rolls and had voted before. What happened, and I looked into this, the reason I recognized him is, as we do vital records in my office, people come to get their birth certificates changed and corrected in my office. And that's how I knew him. He was a Fed, always going by Fed, went to school as a Fed. But when he went to renew his driver's license, his birth certificate had Hicks on it, Charlie Fred Hicks. And so we run into one of those situations where that's where my last contact was with him, was in my office trying to, this man who can't read and write good and all that, trying to help him figure out how to get his birth certificate corrected so he could get his driver's license and the name he'd always been known by. So that was the initial confusion. And in hindsight, I should have let the provisional process go through. His vote probably wouldn't have counted because the names were different. But I let him vote, and that's completely on me. That was not right. It's also one of those things where it's his duty to update his voter registration information. I know that. That's what the law says. And when he got his new driver's license, he should have said, "Hey, DDS, renew my information on there," and everything would have been clear. But he didn't do that. Probably didn't know to do that. And I don't put any blame on him. He was at that point stuck in one of those situations where, because his birth certificate was wrong, whenever he was born, he now had a problem. And in hindsight, I did that wrong. I should have made them both provisional. I tell you all that just to let you know what was going on in our county. The poll workers were ready to let him vote provisional. They're good folks, they know what to do. And if I kept my nose out of it, he'd vote provisional, vote as a candidate. Turned out it didn't matter either way. There was a 3-vote difference in the election instead of a 1-vote difference, so I didn't have to suffer that. But anyway, y'all got any questions for me?
So Judge, thanks for being here.
Yes.
So his driver's license has Charlie Fred Hicks on it?
Yes, sir.
And he's in the rolls as Charlie Fed?
Yes, sir.
So could you issue him a voter ID card in the name of Charlie Fed that would solve his problems?
I don't think so, Mr. Secretary, because he has a photo ID, and I don't think we can, these fine folks may not.
I think, Chris, couldn't he get a Georgia, a free photo ID?
In the code, if you're issued a driver's license or a state-issued ID card, you're not entitled to a photo.
I think that's where the catch is there between.
So you got a tough situation where if you've got a guy on your voter rolls in one name and a driver's license is in another name.
And it's not necessarily his fault. He
right.
should have corrected it, but he's an elderly black gentleman, and he had his niece there helping him that day. He's just not the one who was going to go through all the steps to get everything right, and he wouldn't have. And so, but at the same time, I should have let him, I don't think his vote would have counted if I'd let him vote provisional, but
well,
I
that'd
think
be trouble to do, though, in my opinion. So I'm, you know, speaking for myself, I'm glad you let him vote. And then I had one more question, if you don't mind. So Ms. Blake was saying here that, alleging that the tabulation was not done in public and some voters were not allowed to cast provisional ballots. I assume y'all did your tabulations in public?
We did. I know you've been to Seminole County. When you come towards my office, there's an elections room I have off the right. It's not a large room, but we keep the door open, and on election night, I stand out in the hall while my IT person and my registrars and everybody are in there actually doing the tabulation. I usually do crowd control, and I invite especially candidates and the news people. The newspaper editor's always there by my side, but I invite them, hey, y'all may want to come look at this. Just for that. When we did the recount, too, because there was a requested recount, and I went ahead and did it, I actually took the two mayoral candidates and I made room for them and set them down in front of the machines where they could see everything that was going on. So I don't know what you could have done.
I applaud you for going around on election day to the precincts. I know there's not many probate judges that have the time or make the effort to do that, so I'm very appreciative of that. Does anyone else have any questions for the judge? All right. Thank you.
I will say, and don't want to be long-winded, but on the voter certificates and provisional voting, since then we have, in all of our training, we really stress, hey, y'all sign this. And when you look at it, sign it. And I'm sure there's better training we can do, but I'm the one in charge of it, so we got the best we got there. So, thank you.
We appreciate the confidence you have. Anyone else wishing to speak on this matter? All right. Do we have any discussion with the board or motions?
Well, I think Judge Sheffield did the right thing by letting the man vote, even though his documentation was incorrect. I mean, if he knew him, knew he was a registered voter, and identify him and let him vote. You said that may not have been the right thing to do. In my opinion, that was the right thing to do, just to let the man vote. I mean, that's everybody's entitled to vote. We don't want anybody to be prevented from voting. technically improper. I don't think it was wrong. So I would move to dismiss that allegation against.
All right, we got a motion by Mr. Simpson to dismiss the one allegation. Do we have a second? I'll second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. That motion carries. Do we have a motion or discussion on the other items?
I move to bind those two charges over.
Well, we got a motion to bind over the remaining charges. Have a second.
I'll second that.
All right, Ms. Sullivan, second. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. That motion carries. Judge, thank you for being here today. I know that AG's office will work with you to resolve this, and appreciate y'all taking the time to be here and explain what happened. So.
Well, thank y'all much.
Thank you for your service. All right, we moved Lumber City to the foot of the calendar, so we're on the 2013 number 66, the city of Bronwood, Terrell County. That's number 27 in our binder.
Deborah Sapp submitted a complaint with a number of allegations regarding issues she observed at the City of Bronwood polling precinct during the November 5th, 2013 City of Bronwood general election and the December 3rd, 2013 City of Bronwood general runoff. She was a poll watcher. We were unable to substantiate a number of the allegations that she made, such as the city superintendent took personal phone calls while working inside polling precincts. The city election superintendent stated that they needed a new ballot box because she had to use a piece of metal to push the ballots down inside. The city election superintendent made a comment that a social security card was an acceptable form of ID. The investigation revealed out of the 15 report allegations, two were substantiated. Allegation number nine, it was confirmed that an elector was allowed to vote her ballot from her vehicle during the November 5th, 2013 municipal election. The polling precinct had adequate access to the precinct to allow the voter to use a walker to gain access. And allegation 15, the badge issued to poll watcher Deborah Sapp did not display the required information such as the primary or election and precinct in which the poll watcher was serving. We recommend the following respondents be bound over to the AG's office for the list of violations. The City of Bronwood and Davina Davila, the City Election Superintendent.
Any questions for Ms. Jones? Anyone else wishing to speak? Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon. I'm Deborah Sapp. My address is 174 Thornton Street, Bronwood, Georgia, 39826. First off, I would just really like to commend this board on this wonderful way that you hold hearings. My family often goes to city council meetings, and your hearings are so organized and pleasant, and you actually want to hear from the citizens, which I think is a wonderful thing. And you are to be commended. Thank you. In regards to being a poll watcher, I was not given any training whatsoever. I was asked to be a poll watcher by one of the candidates. I was not given any training. I didn't know. But I had seen several things in the past at elections that I thought were irregularities. And so I went in there very cautious. And I went in there with a lot of paper, and I went in there with a pen. And when I start taking notes, I take copious notes. And I took notes of just about everything. And so some of these things that they say that there isn't any evidence for. I would think that notes taken in time would be evidence. I'm not a lawyer, don't even play one on TV, but I do have some of those. I have my handwritten notes, I still have them. And so to me, that would be evidence. I wish that an investigator had spoken to me. Mr. Archie was very good on communicating with me via email and that type of thing, but when it got down to this part, I wish I had been able to ask some questions such as, so what did you find and what did they respond to, for instance, an ID card that was red and black and I couldn't see any kind of photo on it. So what did they respond? What ID did they say they had used instead of that? And when a voter, Maxwell Johnson, had said, you know, that his ID said he lived in Albany, but they allowed him to vote anyway, and I wish I had been informed, so what evidence was presented to say that is not how it was. The ballot box has been a joke for years. It has a cardboard divider down the middle. And Mr. Villa would take this funky little flat piece of metal and just always make a joke about having to shove them down in there. I did not know until I was sitting here listening to several of these things that a voter could request a poll watcher to aid them in voting. Is that true? Did I misunderstand? I misunderstood that? Thank you. I don't know the rules. Like I said, I was untrained in this. I was trying my best. I read the law. But it seems like there are a lot of parameters that are expected that are not in the law. For instance, just a moment ago, I heard Ms. Jones say that a poll watcher was not allowed to sit where she could see what was going on. I didn't even know that that was something that was supposed to be done. My seating was very firmly made clear across the room. Or I would have made that as an allegation. But I didn't even know that that was something. You know, I don't know what evidence was given that Terry Jenkins no longer, or that she did live in Brownwood when she made several comments there in the polling room that she did not live in Brownwood. I don't know what evidence was given to say that Reuben Hawkins, who was a candidate, had not come inside the polling precinct. I saw him. My note in time showed that he was there. It is a, you could ask almost anybody who votes in Brownwood. He has always been there. He's sitting, waiting for long periods of time in the polling precinct when he would be on the ballot. It was just an expected thing. And even one of the poll workers, Ms. Terry Jenkins, mentioned, well, why haven't you been here? You're usually here to visit with us. We don't know why you're not here. I don't know what kind of evidence was given that city election superintendent Davila did not make a comment about the Social Security card was acceptable form of ID, when again, my notes in time show that she did, so I don't know what the other evidence was. I watched Sandra Jackson vote her husband's ballot. She did, he was not even near her. She grabbed that ballot. She said, here, let me do that. He was still standing in the middle of the rug, and she went over and voted for him. That's not assistance. That's just voting for him. I did not know that it was Eddie Basin who was one of the candidates. I didn't know him by sight. I did not know until later that, yes, that was him who came in to check and see how his name was written on the wall. And then he turned around and went back out. I saw poll officer Jenkins point out to the voters that there was a write-in candidate. She pointed out, see right here, right here. I don't know what evidence was given that did not happen, but again, I have my notes in time. The part about the poll watchers' badges, I find very funny, because I had no idea that they were supposed to be done a certain way at all. We're small town, lots of time where you're not doing anything. At the second election, I was not allowed to bring in anything other than my purse and my paper and pen to take notes on. Couldn't bring in any food, couldn't bring in a book or anything like that. Though the other poll workers got to. So I'm reading some of the things on the wall, and I saw the rules about poll watcher badges, and I thought, what? Well, mine definitely didn't match that. So I added that to my long list of allegations. Lo and behold, I'm really glad I did, since you threw out all the others, except for the fact that the ballot was allowed to leave the precinct room and go out to the voter's car. Again, I'm very thankful to be here. I'm very thankful to be in front of a deliberative body that thinks and doesn't just take things at face value. But I still do have my notes. I almost threw them away. 2 weeks ago, before I got the letter, I almost threw away my poll watcher badges. I still have them. I have them with me. Because I didn't think anything was going to happen. It took so long. Mr. Archer was very good to warn me at the very beginning that it would take a long time. My idea for a long time would be less than a year, but I was wrong. I didn't know some of these things were violations. There have been many violations going on at Cromwell. And I think if the citizens knew some things, y'all have been really good about talking about sending letters of information. I think that there are some things that the citizens need to know, that if you do have a problem, even at, I noticed the last time I went in to vote, that there was a sign on the door saying, if you have a problem, call this number, the Secretary of State's office. I don't remember seeing that sign very often on the door, and I'm really thankful for that. But sometimes you encounter a problem that you don't know is a problem. Like when I had, as a candidate in the past, I had the door shut in my face and told I couldn't watch the county. But I didn't know that that was illegal.
All right, any questions for Ms. Sapp? Thank you for being here today.
Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak on this matter? Okay, hearing none, we have a recommendation to bind over the city and the superintendent for the two potential violations.
I move.
Ms. Sullivan moves to bind over. Do we have a second?
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
In your notes, you say that the registrar, Rebecca Widener, told Ms. Floyd that there were not enough votes to change the outcome of the election, and she didn't need to open the provisional ballot.
That's a different case. We skipped over that one.
Yeah, we're on
that's
the
one.
That's the one we moved to the foot of the count.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I apologize.
No, I'm sorry.
I couldn't figure out.
Yes, ma'am.
I forgot one thing. I'm so sorry. In the first election that was held, the difference, one of the things that was that the superintendent of the election made a determination on a ballot that we couldn't decide who had been voted for. And she said, let me see the signature. It was an absentee ballot. She said, oh, this is how they voted. That election was a tie. And we had to go to a runoff. So her decision, that made a decision in that election.
Okay, thank you. All right. Let's see. Ms. Sullivan, I believe you moved to bind over, is that correct?
That's correct.
Did we have a second?
Second.
We got a second by Mr. Worley. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. That motion carries, and we had bound that over. Ms. Sapp, thank you for being here today. I would keep your notes because the Attorney General's office may want to discuss this as this investigation continues. All right, SCB case 2014, number 2, Twiggs County case, which is number 28 in our binder.
On March 10, 2014, a complaint was received from Twiggs County Election Supervisor Deborah Stevens. Ms. Stevens reported that Twiggs County election officials accidentally allowed a man to vote after confusing him with another family member. Marion Thomas Jr. moved from Danville, Georgia to DeKalb County in 2008, where he registered to vote and obtained an ID card. 2 years later, he moved back to Danville to the same address as his father, Marion Thomas Sr., but did not update his voter registration information regarding his change of address from DeKalb County. During early voting for the City of Danville Municipal Special Election on March 18, 2014, Marion Thomas Jr. reported to the polling place to vote. Mr. Thomas Jr. completed an application for an absentee ballot and presented his photo ID to the Tweeds County Election Superintendent Deborah Stevens. A, Mr. Thomas was located on the voter list at the same address provided by Mr. Thomas Jr. and he was allowed to cast a vote on the DRE. Ms. Stevens was entering the voter's credit information into election yet when she noticed that the Marion Thomas registered in Danville must be Mr. Thomas Sr. because of his date of birth. And by this, she determined that the Marion Thomas Jr. was allowed to vote in error. We recommend that the following individuals be bound over to the AG's office for the listed violations. Deborah Stevens, the Tweeds County Election Superintendent, and Mr. Marion Thomas Jr.
So, Marion Thomas Jr. was, where was he registered?
DeKalb County.
And he voted in
Wilkinson.
Wilkinson.
Tweed.
I mean Tweed.
It's Wilkinson.
It was a municipal election. So.
But it's split between Tweed and Wilkinson.
If the Tweed County voted.
All right, so we're binding, or the recommendation is to bind the elector over because they voted basically under a different name, correct?
Correct.
In their own county. And the superintendent for allowing that to happen.
Yes.
But the superintendent did self-report, correct?
Yes, she called.
Okay. All right, anyone else wishing to speak?
Good afternoon. My name is Lars Anderson. I'm an attorney here in Macon. My office address is 2476 Vineville Avenue, Macon, Georgia, 31204. I represent the Board of Elections for Tweed County. I'm here with Ms. Deborah Stevens. Just to clarify, the gentleman, I'll refer to as Junior, moved from return back home, moved into his father's house, and he did report. Ms. Stevens will be here to tell you she was the one who made the error. She did not, until after he had voted, match up her birth date. And so in essence what had happened, the son had moved back to town, moved back to his father's address, the addresses matched up. We made an error. It was one of, certainly not malice, a willful wrongdoing. I think as demonstrated by Ms. Stevens, certain immediate steps to self-report. Any further questions about the student's address? And any questions about how that happened? I will ask you to direct her.
My name is Deborah Stevens. My address is 194 Family Circle, Jeffersonville, Georgia, 31044. 2013, I became a superintendent, and in the year 2014, I am aware of the accident that I did do. Since then, 2014, we have established new plans on verifying voters' driver's license through voter registration, through the eNet system, and making sure that voters get the accurate voter identifications since then.
All right, well, thank you both for being here. I have one question for you, Ms. Stevens. So,
yes.
did you know the Andersons?
Andersons?
The voter, I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
Thomas.
Yes, the
Thomas.
Yeah, the Thomas, I'm sorry.
No, sir, I didn't know the Thomas. At that time when we did it, it was my first big election, and just the rush of being a newly superintendent, I did not check his, verify his birthday as well as I should have.
Okay. That makes sense. My apologies, Mr. Anderson. I got confused on all these names
here. More trouble than when I arrived.
least we didn't bind you up, right?
Very good.
Okay.
He surrendered.
Okay, thank y'all for being here. Any other questions for Mr. Hanson, Mr. McGuire?
Either one of you that wants to answer, should Mr. Marion Thomas Jr. have reported that his address had changed?
No.
Changed his registration?
No, sir.
No, but should he have done so?
Should he? Yes, sir, he should have paid.
For the system to work, he should have reported he had an address.
He did physically change his residence, but he did not report the change for voting purposes, but had a driver's license which reflected the address which was on the voting rolls. Unfortunately, one was a senior, one was a junior. He lives with his father, at the time, lived with his father.
But the driver's license showed the correct address for voting.
Yes.
In other words, it was not the cab address. It was the Twigs address.
Twigs and Woodson share a municipality together, so it would show Woodson County as his address.
So how was he in E-Net? Was he registered in the cab in E-Net?
Yes. We weren't using E-Net. We was just using our own registration. So now we're using E-Net. And when I went to verify to put his information in after he had filled out his application, I noticed he was in the cab based on the birthday after I pulled up a senior. And I then in return called and reported that I had allowed a voter to vote under a number of the father and not the son.
Okay. All right. Any other questions? Ms. Stevens, are you confident this won't happen again?
Yes, sir. I am. Okay.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak on this matter? Discussion. Motion.
I'll move the letter of instruction B and shoot to both respondents.
I'll second that.
All right, we've got a motion and a second for a letter to be issued for a respondent. Ms. Stevens, can I ask you another question?
Yes, sir.
Did Marion Thomas Jr., do you think he realized where he was registered to vote?
I honestly don't think he realized where he was registered to vote at, because he didn't come in as a person that was trying to do anything to see.
Okay.
It was a municipal election and he just ran to vote.
Mr. Secretary, can I add to that? Yes. I did have a discussion with Marion Thomas over the phone, and I honestly believe he did not have any idea he was doing anything wrong.
Well, that was what I certainly, I just had some concern about not the letter from Ms. Stevens, but with Marion Thomas, which I'm fine if he legitimately was just confused about where it was registered. I can live with the letter. I just wanted to make sure that was the case. I hope Ms. Sullivan and Mr. Worley will understand that. Thank you very much. Any other discussion? We have a motion and a second for a letter of instruction for both respondents. Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. That motion carries and we'll issue the letters. 2014 number 39, Glenn County. That would be number 29.
Our office received a complaint from Glenn County Election Supervisor Tina Edwards concerning Zach Lyde causing a disruption at the borough's Mollett School polling precinct and that he had to be escorted out by local police. The incident occurred on May 20th, 2014 during the primary election. Zach White entered the borough's Mallett polling location and caused a disturbance during the May 20th, 2014 election. During the incident, he became loud, aggressive, and uncooperative with both poll manager and the deputy that was assigned to the precinct. He was yelling at the poll manager that she was giving misinformation and turning voters away. Mr. White also shouted at the deputy that he was going to have to shoot him or tase him because he was not leaving. There were two electors voting when the incident occurred, and Mr. White refused to leave the polling location when asked to do so by the poll manager, Elaine Harnster, and Deputy Wooten. Deputy Wooten reported that he informed Mr. White that he was causing a public disturbance and interfering with the normal flow of business in the precinct. Mr. White did not walk outside the polling location until additional deputies arrived on scene and Colonel Stacy Young escorted him out. We recommend that that lie be mailed over to the AG's office for the list of violations.
Any questions for Ms. Jones? Anyone else wishing to speak? So, Ms. Jones, would any of that be criminal in nature? Well, I assume it's under our jurisdiction and not the city's.
Well, it's my understanding they sent information to the DA's office, and the DA wanted to wait until it was heard through our agency before they made a decision about whether to prosecute them.
I'm not sorry, I was outside talking. Are you asking about the DA's role in this case?
Yes.
Chris Harvey, Georgia Secretary of State's office. When the DA contacted me as chief investigator a couple years ago, she asked what we would do with this case, what the state election board would do. And I said, you know, we would do an investigation, the state election board would consider it for administrative action. At that point, she seemed fine with that. She indicated she didn't really think it needed to go criminally as long as it would be addressed by this board. I indicated, obviously, that the board didn't have a criminal jurisdiction, but they would consider it and take appropriate administrative action. And I think she was fine with that. I don't think, unless something has changed, she has intentions of pursuing any kind of criminal activity.
Yeah, my concern would be with us getting in front of a criminal investigation. But if that's not the case, then I certainly don't mind moving forward.
What's significant to me is they escorted him out and didn't place him under arrest.
Sounds like you ought to be thankful he didn't get tased. Sure, that's what you would have done. Anyone else wishing to speak? Yes, sir.
I'm Richard Wood. I'm on the Board of Elections in Clinton County. Excuse me. The address is 1815 Gloucester Street, Georgia. The original intent of the board was to have this matter presented to the district attorney's office. For two felony counts and one misdemeanor count. Excuse me. And somehow in the proceedings it ended up in the Secretary of State's investigation. The Glynn County Sheriff's Office was doing an investigation into the matter and was reporting it to the district attorney for that county. I'm not sure how, in the process of things, the investigation was diverted to the Secretary of State's office, and it was my impression that the board wanted it handled by the district attorney's office of Glynn County.
All right, any questions? Mr. McGowan,
in whose capacity do you appear?
I am a board member for the Board of Elections in Glynn County.
Well, I think, I guess I'm correct in assuming this, that the complaint originally came to us through the election superintendent?
I don't recall originally. I remember specifically the district attorney called me personally and asked about us taking the case from
them. Ms. Edwards forwarded the complaint.
She's also here for the next matter. All right, if you have a question for her.
And I believe that was that the board directed her to send a letter to the district attorney's office for it being presented to her, and in my opinion, as a courtesy, it was reported to Mr. Harvey.
Well, Yeah, I'm open to whatever the board wants to do, the state election board, but I certainly, I'm open to whatever the locals want to do as well, but I know a lot of times it's tough sometimes for the VAs to move forward on something like this, but we're, you know, Mr. Harvey, you were saying that she's all right with us moving forward?
Well, again, when I spoke to her originally, she was very happy that the state election board would handle this, and she didn't indicate any, that she was planning on taking action either alongside or instead of the state election board. Like I said, she called me and said, and essentially asked that the state election board handle this for her, unless something has changed in that time. That was the last conversation I had with her.
I'd like to add that the Burroughs Millette is an elementary school, and the classes were actually being let out at the time the census occurred.
I have a question, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, Mr. McGuire has a question.
Mr. Zach Lye, do we have notice on him?
Yes, well, Mr.
His parent is not here.
Yeah, we attempted to contact him both by telephone, by certified letter, and in person. Investigator Archie actually went to his residence and could hear activity inside and left a note on his door. We never heard anything from him.
So. Okay. All right, thank you, Mr. Ward. Anyone else wishing to speak on this matter? Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon, I'm Tina Edwards. Address 1850 Gloucester Street, Birmingham, Georgia, 31520, election supervisor. Just wanted just to report that Mr. Light is aware. He came to my office with a friend of his and noted that he did receive his information and he was well aware of the hearing today. He didn't tell me if he was coming or not, but I just want to let you know he is fully aware that he did receive the information.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ms. Anyone else wishing to speak? Do we have a motion?
I'm moving to bind over.
All right, Mr. McGuire moves to bind over.
A second.
Ms. Sullivan seconds. Any other discussion?
I would just note that I don't think the state election board actually here would complete the district attorney for proceeding if the DA said that. But I hate for this to dismiss this case without taking any action, without the state election board taking any action, without knowing whether or not the DA
would
prosecute it.
Well, they
will
come back to us,
you know, once the law department's done what they've done.
Well,
I can contact the district attorney's office to find out if they're going to take any action on it, because my understanding is in the past the board has not acted on cases.
Yeah, and we don't want to get in a double jeopardy.
Oh, one more comment, if you don't mind. It's been my impression that the district attorney's purpose was waiting for Mr. Harvey to produce a report so she could determine whether or not there was prosecuting grounds here. And in our last contact with her, the district attorney, indicated that she had not received that report.
Well, one thing that we could do, and we've done this in the past, is we could recommend that this be referred to the Attorney General's office. But we're getting mixed signals here, and Mr. Harvey's saying that he spoke to the DA, and she was saying that she was glad we were taking this. So I guess one action we could take would be to vote to refer to the AG's office if that's what the board wants to do, and if the DA doesn't want to move forward, then we can take it up again. Of course, that's going to prolong the process, but we do have a motion and a second on the.
But under any circumstances, it comes back to us. So the law department does whatever they've done.
Right. I think the issue is, though, in the past, it's my recollection, and you've been on the board a lot longer than I have. But it seems like that we have not taken actions to refer it to the AG's office. If there was a criminal, you know, if there was a criminal element, then we would refer. refer it to the AG, I mean, to the DA to see if they would prosecute, and if they didn't, then we could, that would still leave the door open for us to refer it to the AG and let them prosecute on the civil side. But I think if we take action to refer it to the AG's office, that could jeopardize that.
Seems like to me, if we send it to the Attorney General's office, then the Attorney General has some input or say-so about whether it goes back to the local DA, or whether they say we recommend to us that we proceed administratively. Isn't that an option that the DA would have? I mean, the Attorney General's office would have?
We can certainly talk to the district attorney to find out what, if, whether or not they are pursuing the case. I don't know that.
We're not locked in to an administrative action just because we refer it to the AG's office. Is that correct? Well, so my kind of motion is appropriate.
Suits me. All in favor? Mr. Worthy?
I just wanted to say something before we go. I've been on the board now for 12 years, and I've never seen a situation like this where somebody was so, seemed to be so deliberately interfering with the election process and the polling place. And so I think we need to do whatever we can to prosecute this person civilly or criminally. And it sounds like the DA's office may just be happy to have had the Secretary of State's office do the investigation, and hopefully we'll take the file and proceed with it. But I'm going to vote against.
Okay. I completely agree with Mr. Ward. All right. Anything else? Got a motion and a second to bind over. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, same sign. That motion carries, and we've bound that over. We've got one more of Glenn County case, 2014-110-30-500.
Our office received a complaint from the Glenn County Election Board member, Richard Good, with multiple allegations concerning irregularities by election supervisor Tina Edwards during the November 4th, 2014 general election and the July 22nd, 2014 primary runoff. There are several allegations centered on issues with the handling of provisional absentee ballots for both elections. We were unable to substantiate one of the allegations made regarding the mailing of an absentee ballot out to the name of the deceased voter, Mr. William Wheeler, and his wife, Edna Wheeler, voting the ballot. That was unsubstantiated. However, the investigation did reveal concerns with the remaining allegations. Regarding the November 2014 general election, allegation one, the investigation revealed that two provisional ballots were misplaced and not located until November the 10th, 2014. During the investigation, it was learned that two voters had reported to the incorrect voting polling precinct on election day. The poll manager, LaVonda Clark, issued the voters provisional ballots so they could cast their ballots. The poll manager failed to ensure all procedures were followed when the voters voted their provisional ballots. She failed to ensure the provisional envelope was inserted into the outer salmon color envelope and that it was sealed. The poll manager also failed to have the voters insert their ballots into the provisional ballot container. And her actions contributed to the ballots being misplaced and not found until November the 10th. Allegation two, the investigation revealed the election supervisor, Tina Edwards, failed to have at least two assistants present on November the 10th when the two recovered provisional ballots were duplicated. During the investigation, it was learned that on November the 10th, assistant election supervisor Monica Couch located the two missing provisional ballots, and Tina Edwards advised that the ballots had to be counted by 5 p.m. And at that time, it was 3:45. She stated she called the county attorney and informed her he needed at least 2 hours to render a decision. Ms. Edwards advised it was already 4:45 by then, and she was thinking that she'd be in huge trouble if she didn't get the ballots counted. So she decided to duplicate the ballots with only one person present. In regard to allegation three, 25 original voted provisional ballots were inserted back into their seven color envelopes after they were duplicated. The secrecy of the ballots was not maintained by doing that. Our investigator also reviewed the documents and located 25 provisional ballots where the original ballot had been inserted back into the salmon color envelope. The investigator determined that the secrecy of the ballots was not maintained since the ballots had not been separated from their envelope with the electors' names written on them. During the review of the election documents, the investigator also found 11 Yukawa envelopes from the November 4th, 2014 general election that contained marked ballots. The oath of the electors were attached to the envelope so you could identify the voter. During the review of the election documents from July 22nd, 2014, primary runoff, the investigator found 4 open Yukawa envelopes that contained marked ballots. Allegation 4 is related to the July 2014 primary runoff. The investigation revealed that during the July 22nd, 2014 primary runoff, an elector named Alice Crawford voted by absentee ballot, but she failed to sign her name on the oath. The election office received Alice Crawford's ballot, and it should have been rejected, but it was certified and counted. Election supervisor Tim Edwards advised that it was human error and should have been rejected. We recommend that the following respondents be bound over to the AG's office for the listed violations. Glenn County Board of Elections and Registration, Tina Edwards, election supervisor, and Lavonia Clark, poll manager.
And then is that it?
And then Monica Couch, assistant election supervisor.
And on the other, absentee ballots, we're holding on that?
Yes, sir. We were not going to make a recommendation on that and hear it later.
Per our earlier comments, yeah. All right, any questions for Ms. Jones? Anyone wishing to speak?
Good afternoon.